Hey guys, it's Celestia. I hope you're all having a good holiday season, despite everything happening. I know things are hard right now, and they're a lot harder to handle when most of us can't see our family when we need them the most. I hope you're all taking care of yourselves and finding ways to stay happy. And I'm kind of glad that you guys voted for this story time on Twitter, because hopefully it'll be crazy enough to bring you guys some laughs. Find solace in 13-year-old me's misery. I know I do. First, though, the art. I've got two more speed paints of my recent apparel designs, and today's is one of them. Similarly to last time, I'd like to give you guys some insight into my genius inspiration here, but the inspiration was that the Kitsune aesthetic is cool, so let's make it a shirt. I also have a million problems with how it turned out, but I went back and fixed the most glaring ones, which you can see closer to the end. If you like the design, you can find it for sale on t-shirts and sweatshirts via the links in the description. Alright, so let me take you back to 2011, to young, foolish, 13-year-old Celestia, and tell you how my very first relationship was with someone who straight up did not exist. Young me, just like current old me, was really into Death Note. That's an anime for anyone who doesn't know, although if you're on my channel I can only imagine you at least know of Death Note, because I'm pretty sure most of you are as weeby as me. Anyway, in Death Note, there's a notebook that lets you kill anyone by writing their name and means of death in it. There's a lot more to it than that, but that's all you need to know for the context of the story. So, 13-year-old me, obsessed with this anime, is viciously digging through the internet for more content related to it, and I come across an app. I won't name it, and it's gone from the App Store now, but it was essentially just a virtual Death Note. It existed so that people all around the world could write the names of people they wanted to die in it, which is kind of fucked up in retrospect, but whatever. Anyway, because the app publicly displayed the names that people wrote in it and kept a log of them, a lot of people within this really niche community actually used it as an anonymous message board. Instead of writing names, we would write messages to each other with tags of our names after, and eventually this led to an established Death Note roleplay group. It was about 50% original characters and 50% canon characters, and I roleplayed an original character. And to avoid confusion, from here on out I won't change the names of the canon character roleplayers, because there's obviously nothing connecting those names to the people involved, but I will change the names of the OC roleplayers for the sake of their privacy. The only exception is the one OC who was literally a female mellow named Mella, and I'm not changing that one because I'm pretty sure there are a million people who have done that and it's not connected to the roleplayer individually. Obviously, I did come to know these people's real names, but I won't be using them in the video, and I'll just refer to them as who they roleplayed. I don't think there's a huge chance of any of them seeing this, but because the community was so small and niche, I don't want to risk revealing anyone's actual identities to anyone else who might remember the app. So I'm vibing on this app, roleplaying a Death Note OC and being as cringe as a 13-year-old weeb can possibly be. I drew her a lot, and I'll put up one of the beautiful pieces I drew of her with my preteen expertise. You're welcome. Anyway, it was fun, but I really started getting into it one night when I met Matt. Matt is a character from Death Note, which is who he was roleplaying, but I also later learned that Matt was also apparently his real name, which I'll get back to again later. It's funny, I still remember the night that I met him so clearly. Like, it was 10 years ago now, but I had such a crush on him so quickly that I was refreshing the app constantly to see if he'd replied. We started talking more, roleplaying together regularly, and the app kind of started to flourish as a roleplay community. So relationships and plots between both the writers and the characters developed. The main group of us consisted of me, Matt, a mellow roleplayer, an original character who I'll call Alpha, and the aforementioned OC called Mella. There were a lot more regulars on there too, and there were other friends in the group that didn't roleplay but still hung out with us, but this was the roleplay group that I was most associated with. As it turns out, Matt, Mello, and Mella all knew each other in real life, and Mello and Mella were siblings. Which didn't raise any red flags for me, apparently, despite how weirdly unlikely that actually was, but anyway, this little group was so closely knit that we ended up talking outside of the app too, usually on Tiny Chat, the prime video chat site in 2011 where all the cool kids went, and sometimes on Facebook. And eventually, Matt and I started dating. It's worth mentioning that around this time, Alpha and Mella also started dating. So this goes on for several months, and I'm genuinely so happy. I'm having fun, I'm video chatting every night, I have a whole group of friends that I'm always excited to talk to. The thing is, the only people I actually saw on camera when we video chatted were Mella, Alpha, and another friend from the app who didn't roleplay but loved the anime and hung out with us on Tiny Chat a lot. I don't remember the reason Matt gave for never going on camera, but I clearly believed it, and Mello just claimed not to be interested in joining in. This is my first relationship ever, even if it is online, so the rose-colored glasses of young love kind of obscure all those red-ass flags. But here's where things start to fall apart. Matt breaks up with me out of nowhere, says he was actually in love with Mella this whole time and wanted to make her jealous by being with me, tells me he wants nothing to do with me anymore, and drops off the face of the fucking earth. Naturally, because I was 100% sure he was the one, my heart was broken. Which, in retrospect, is hilarious because looking back, I got over it real fast based on what happened next. Mello comforted me through the breakup, and we got a lot closer, and then I started dating him instead. He and Matt fought about me before Matt left altogether, and he defended me, so my heart was practically his as soon as he asked me out. And if I thought Matt and I were serious, Mello and I were basically married by 13-year-old standards within a few months. We knew each other's addresses, he sent me gifts, we were planning to meet, we were in a relationship on Facebook, this was going places. We were obviously madly in love. But because things were more serious, it was increasingly less and less okay with me that he wouldn't video chat with us. I was 13, but I wasn't stupid, and while at first I was just really desperate to see what my boyfriend looked like, it started turning into actual suspicion eventually. And then during a video chat with Mella, I heard a male voice in the background, and she told me it was Mello and that he said hi. It could have been her dad, but I'd met her dad, and it didn't sound like him, so this was enough for me to keep pushing the suspicion away for a while longer. Not indefinitely, but longer. Things went on like that for a long-ass time. My friends from real life met the group in video chat. I started talking to my dad about visiting them. Our relationship was legitimately public. Like, I found this cringe-ass screenshot from a post from him on my Facebook wall that I'll put up. Without his first name, because he used his real one with Mello's last name. It physically hurts me to remember that this was something my real-life friends saw and commented on, and potentially still remember. It's my greatest shame. But because of how public and real this shit was, he started falling under the scrutiny of my real-life friends. I opened up that I was worried that he might not be real, because while I was friends on Facebook with Mello's real-life account, and even her dad's, Mello's was a throwaway account with only friends from the roleplay group, and an anime profile picture, and I'd never seen his face. They told me to confront him about it, but I didn't want to risk ruining what we had if I was wrong, so in true world's greatest detective fashion, I found an alternative. I too created a throwaway Facebook account, used a profile picture that I distinctly remember finding through a Google search of Scene Girl, and because I knew where Mella lived and went to school, I put my hometown and school as hers. Then I messaged her and Mello's dad and said, "Hey, I think I know your son Mello. Haven't seen him at school for a bit, wanted to make sure he was okay." And this absolute motherfucker read the message and didn't answer. Now, I'm sure you know where this is going, so it's no surprise that Mello did not, in fact, turn out to be a real person, which makes this part even more unbelievable to me. Mello's dad legitimately knew what was really going on and chose not to tell me about it. This grown-ass adult man decided to actively further the lie rather than tell me the truth, and that gets me heated to this day. But getting back to the story, because I didn't get a response either way, I wasn't sure what to really make of that. He didn't confirm or deny Mello's existence, but he had seen the message, leaving me to frantically theorize as to why he wouldn't answer and what that could mean. Pretty soon after that, I finally confronted him, and he gave in pretty easily and told me that he was actually Mella, and that she made Mello up. I'm guessing this was because her dad told her about the message and she figured the lie was nearing the end of its shitty little lifespan anyway, but this is where it gets really fucking weird, so buckle up. She explains that she's bisexual, and she didn't think that I was into girls, so she made up a fake brother in order to date me. But not only that, she was still dating Alpha the entire time, who knew that Mello didn't exist, and knew that Mello was actively dating both of us. He was fine with her dating me via a fake identity, and he justified her lies until the very end. I was fucking appalled. Like, it was too crazy for me to properly process it. I had considered that Mello might not be real for a while now, but I could not have predicted that Mella and Alpha essentially wanted me to be in a polyamorous relationship with them, and that she, Alpha, and her fucking dad were all in on the lie. And naturally, I was pissed. Things get a little fuzzy here, which is probably reasonable, given that I was very stressed and it's been a decade, but I know we stopped talking for quite a while after that. Eventually, months later, maybe longer than that, she messaged me on Facebook and apologized for everything, to which I said that I appreciated the apology, but what she did was super messed up, and I didn't accept it or forgive her. This is when I find out that she and Alpha are still dating, and I find this out because he very angrily adds and messages me on Facebook, telling me that I've made her cry, and that I have no right to still be mad about this, and pretty much just yells at me for an hour before I give up arguing and block him, as well as Mella. And this, fortunately, is where the story ends for me, because I haven't heard from either of them since. But in conclusion, my first and second relationships were with people who did not even a little bit exist. Both Mella and Alpha claim that Matt was real, which Alpha verified by saying that he'd seen Matt on camera once, but I'm pretty sure Mella just lied to him about that and had a friend over that she passed off as Matt. Keep in mind that half of Matt's personality by the end of things was to simp for Mella and try to make her jealous, and it wouldn't surprise me if that was both to get me deeper into a relationship with Mello and to make Alpha jealous of Matt's love for Mella. It's also kind of sus that he straight up disappeared when he was no longer of use to her narrative, and that Alpha only briefly saw him one time. I mentioned earlier that Matt was supposedly both the character's name and the guy's name, and this is why that's so fucking funny to me. Because clearly when I asked for his real name, I put Mella on the spot, and she just couldn't think of anything and used the same name. Or she was legitimately that lazy, who's to say. But honestly, looking back on all this from an adult's eyes, I'm less furious at Mella and more furious at her father for pretty much actively allowing this all to happen. Mella was 13 too, and while I didn't make up a fake brother and pretend to be him, I did lie about a lot of stuff to that group to sound cool and get attention because I was a lonely, stupid preteen, and I can only imagine that she was in the same boat there. Anyway, that's the story of my two fake boyfriends. As it turns out, I actually ended up meeting my partner online, also roleplaying Death Note, but on Tumblr. So good things do come from the fandom after all. I hope you guys enjoyed today's video, and if you did, please consider leaving a like and subscribing. Also, while I'm in my obligatory self-promotion section of the video, please check out my Ko-fi as well if you enjoy my content. I post exclusive speed paints and doodles there, as well as discount codes for my store and commissions, and all of the proceeds from it are currently going towards funding my partner and I's move from a very homophobic town. New supporters also get a small random doodle, and monthly supporters get one for every month that they support me. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in my next video.